Biochemistry is an amazing science that uses the principles of chemistry to understand the molecules of life. From small molecules like this one, to larger ones like this, and ultimately macromolecules like proteins and assemblies of proteins. We then use this knowledge to understand how chemistry or metabolism happens in the cell, but also to understand how and why the different components of the cell function as they do. Because the beauty is that basically all of the functions of the cell are ultimately governed by the functions of its organelles and supramolecular complexes, like the plasma membrane, then the molecules and macromolecules in them, and ultimately their building blocks or monomeric units, like this amino acid. So if you want to understand anything, and if you want to start simply, we need to start here to understand the chemistry of life. Of all the chemical elements on Earth, only a fairly small number are relevant in biology. Some metals are important in catalyzing the chemistry in the cell. Some odd elements have very specific roles in just one or two specific places, like iodine in the thyroid hormone. And finally, elements like sodium, potassium, and chlorine are important for the ionic balance in the cell, and they're also important for signaling in nerve cells. But the actual chemistry we're going to look at here happens just with six of these elements: hydrogen, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, phosphorus, and sulfur. That's no coincidence, because these are the only ones that can form large, complex molecules. So at the beginning of everything in biochemistry, we need to understand how the atoms of these elements join up to form molecules. If you already know chemistry pretty well, then you can lean back a little bit, but not for too long. In very basic terms, the ability of an element to form chemical bonds depends on unpaired electrons in the outer or valence shell of the atoms. Hydrogen only has a single electron shell and just one electron in it. Helium has a pair of electrons in that shell, and that's why helium doesn't do any chemistry, while hydrogen does. The elements on the next period down have all the same filled-up first electron shell like hydrogen does, as well as a second electron shell, and this is now the outermost or the valence shell. This second shell has room for four electron pairs, but as you can see, the electrons like to stay single for as long as they can. All atoms are the most stable if their valence shell is filled with a maximal number of electrons. For hydrogen, that means it needs one more. For carbon, nitrogen, and oxygen, it means four, three, or two electrons are missing for these atoms to be as stable as neon. And this is where the magic of chemistry happens. Atoms can come together and share an electron pair to fill up that valence shell. So if we simplify the drawing, a carbon atom with its four lonely electrons can pair up with four hydrogen atoms. Oxygen, on the other hand, already has two pairs of electrons and only two lonely ones, so it can only share electrons with two hydrogen atoms. These shared electron pairs that join up atoms to form molecules are what we call covalent bonds. Covalent bonds have a number of properties that define the stability and geometry of the molecule. They are strong, they have a pretty narrowly defined length, and they are directional. And as we're going to see, the directionality determines the geometry of the molecule. Drawing molecules with all those dots is a bit too much work, so instead we just draw a line between the two atoms to indicate a covalent bond between them, like so. Occasionally we want to show that an atom has additional unbonded electron pairs that may at some point engage in a chemical reaction. And in that case, we add a shorter line near the atom, like this. Sometimes two atoms share more than one pair of electrons. If they share two pairs, like the carbon and oxygen here, we have a double bond. Carbon is uniquely able to also form triple bonds with another carbon atom. And these do some really interesting chemistry, but they're very rare in biological molecules, so we don't really need to worry about them here. You'll notice that I've drawn these molecules with double and triple bonds differently from those with single bonds. And that is because they do actually have different geometry, and That is hugely important for the structure of biomolecules, as we're going to see later. For now, if you take away just one thing from this video, remember how many bonds each of the main elements of life can form. Hydrogen 1, carbon 4, oxygen 2, nitrogen 3, sulfur 2, at least in the compounds that we're going to come across, and phosphorus 5. There's no point in memorizing this. When you draw molecular structures on paper, which I recommend, it'll soon become second nature to check that the correct number of bonds are all there.